I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Secretary Peggy Norris, do you have a thought of the day for us, by chance?
If people listened to themselves more often, they would talk less.
Okay, thank you, Peggy. Okay, we have a lot of a big program today, but also a few business things to also go over. Over to our speaker, Jim Jones. He's also handed out materials as well, so.
No PowerPoint this morning.
I'm sorry.
Can I help at all, Mike?
No, I'm good. I just got glasses on here to lead the information. So, time being short, I wanted to leave a lot of time for questions for anybody that had those burning questions about what's going on in the county. But so I handed out 4 pages of material that it covers the last 10 years. The 10 years, coincidentally, that I've been working as county administrator. And one of the things that I believe in as far as analysis is that and the capture of data is that trend analysis is probably, while not the best or the only predictor of what the future is going to be, I believe it's the best predictor of day-to-day operations, because you can year over year you can say what did I do last year. If I do those same things next year at the upcoming price, whatever your union agreements are for payroll, whatever your anticipation is for revenue projections or inflation on other expenses, and what am I going to do different? And so you look for anomalies in history. You say, oh my God, we had a big spike up here in something. What happened? But generally, things tend to go the way things have always gone. And so that's why I believe in trend analysis. I'll cover just a couple of brief things in these 4 pages and then open for questions. So one of the cushions or the only real safety net that commissioners have, and make no mistake, the commissioners are in charge of the budget. Okay, the legislative body in a county like ours, where the commissioners are both legislative and executive, the budget is a function of the county commissioners, and they set priorities and tell you how to build it. So this is data you can see, but the biggest cushion they have to cover any one-time issue in particular is the ending fund balance, the reserve fund. And if you see on page 1, that's 4 lines down where it says ending fund balance, you can see that in 2005 we ended with $7,821,873 in the general fund versus a fund expense of $27,022,701. It's really a solid area. If you look further back, you can see back in 2001 the fund balance is only $4,000,009. So the commissioners and the former administrator working on behalf of the commissioners had started the trend of trying to put money aside, trying to cushion for any kind of emergency that might come along. Well, that was when I started. I started in 2006. And we ended 2015 with $11,982,613. So you can see over time, the general fund increased 53.2%. And 3 of those years, 2009 through 2011, we suffered through the worst recession since 1929. So the group of commissioners, all of the good department heads, elected officials, have all been working together, and it takes an incredible team. The county is a very, very complex organization, very complex. And you know, my job as county administrator is better described as being a mile wide but only an inch deep. I have to know a little bit about what everybody's doing to deal with the day-to-day operations. But decisions are made strategically, priority-wise, by the commissioners, budget-wise. Budgets are all made by the individual department heads. They decide how they're going to spend the money. The commissioners decide how much money they get. And essentially, the commissioners, under our policies and under our charter, are in control of the number of people that are hired. Okay, the commissioners have a decision to make on allowing the number of FTE. So again, you can see in 2001 we had 422.10 full-time equivalent employees in the county. The commissioners, in controlling the budget, in deciding our single biggest expense is people. A little over 70% of all money we spend is on people, salary and benefits. And they use the number of people to control the way the expectation and the amount of money. You can see we went down to, in 2013, 362.29. We've since come up. We're up this year to 391.90. So, as I mentioned, they did this all by attrition. When the big recession hit in 2009. I can't tell you how many. I go to an annual conference every year, and I'm on a listserv with my fellow county administrators, county managers, and a few county executives that we keep in track. I can't tell you how many counties laid off people in 2009. Clallam County did not lay off anyone. They used the reserves to cushion the impact. They did impose a very, very strict, commissioners imposed a very, very strict no rehire policy. They changed policy, and they in the policy they gave me the authority to work with each department head to determine absolutely whether, when somebody left of their own accord, whether they retired or they went to work somewhere else, whether or not that person would be replaced. And I would sit down and work with each department head and talk about it. I'd make the recommendation to the commissioners if they were asking to be replaced. If they were not, we just eliminated the position from the budget. And that's how we controlled the budget. That's how it happened. So a couple of little hot items I wanted to say is that, again, going down the bottom part, the other thing the county does a lot of is we help the local economy with total capital expenditures. This is something that gets lost with most people. We spend a lot of money on capital projects, hopefully hiring local people, certainly local contractors, subcontractors for sure. But we also hire an awful lot of consultants, an awful lot of, we pay for an awful lot of people's services. Well, in this case, this is just capital expenditures. Over the 10 years since 2006, we spent $122,192,000 on capital expenditure. Most of that is roads, $58.9 million for roads, $21.7 million in opportunity fund projects, and $16.1 million for parks and facilities projects, upgrades on the county. So most of those monies come either from road funds, obviously road taxes, grant monies. We get a significant amount of money every year in competitive grants, applying for things like the Olympic Discovery Trails is about almost 87-80% totally funded so far through RCO, federal grants, state grants, and federal grants. As I mentioned, we have a great leadership team. In the 10 years I've been there, 6 different commissioners, 3 prosecutors, 2 sheriffs, 4 community development directors, 2 auditors, 1 assessor, 2 treasurers, 3 district court judges, 6 superior court judges, and 18 different appointed department heads. So it's a lot of people working well together. The department heads, elected officials, are the experts in their area. The commissioners, as again, set the priority on the total number of people hired, on the total amount of the budget, and the department heads, for the most part, spend that the way they want to. So the thing in my tenure here that I'm probably most proud of, and I think the thing that is the most important moving forward into the future, is the intergovernmental cooperation that we've managed to get, and consolidation agreements that we've managed to accomplish. And they've been really tough. We got a revenue sharing agreement with the City of Port Angeles for the Eastern UGA, which is starting at the city limits and going clear out to the Walmart. That area, the revenue sharing agreement, we share with the City of Port Angeles one half of the real estate taxes and the sales tax that comes in on any new business or any business that significantly upgraded their property since that time. And in exchange, they agreed to extend their sewer line and all the way out to Walmart so that we could encourage new businesses to come in. We paid for it. The county paid for that out of a combination of Opportunity Fund grant and REIT funds. But we paid for the extension, and they brought the sewer out there, and then they through our interlocal agreement. And they agreed not to annex for an initial period of 15 years. And then after that, which is up now, by the way, on the annexation, and they agreed that when they did start annexing, and of course they have to get votes from the people, they can't just decide to annex. When they did start annexing, they do it in one of six zones in order. They wouldn't go out and grab the Walmart in the sixth zone to grab all that property tax and sales tax. They have to start at the first zone immediately east of here, and it's all laid out on the ground, and go into the second zone, and then the third zone, then the fourth zone, fifth and sixth. So we have that agreement, and quite frankly, at the time we negotiated that, the expectation was that they would never annex because they're getting half the money of all the new business and not having to provide any of the service. So we also entered into interlocal agreements with the City of Sequim, also from a sewer, and then we got a second meeting with the sewer. We've done one with the City of Sequim for the Carlsberg sewer system, also with the PUD, as far as we're still putting that together as far as how they're going to handle the payments for the collection of the sewer customers in the Carlsberg sewer area. And then the biggie was we just starting the first of this year, we entered into an agreement with the City of Port Angeles, City of Sequim, to consolidate district court, prosecution, public defense, and jailing of all misdemeanor clients, the exact same way we do felony. And some of you may not know that when a felony suspect or somebody accused of a felony happens inside the cities don't pay for anything except arresting that person. Then they turn it over to the prosecutor, we prosecute, we have to pay for public defense, Fulton County pays for the court, Fulton County pays for the jailing unless they get more than a year, and then it goes to the state and then they pay. So we decided to do the same thing there we had a prosecutor and in both cities, and also an assistant that were having to do the prosecution of the misdemeanants. They had to pay for their own public defense. They had to pay their share of the court costs or decide to have their own courts. And then they had to pay for the daily cost of jailing. And you know, there was a lot of bureaucratic sending of bills back and forth, a lot of, you know, when the sheriff has an overcrowded jail and doesn't want to get in a situation like Jefferson County did a number of years ago and get sanctioned by the state for being overcrowded, the sheriff lets people out that are not deemed to be dangerous to society. Well, when they were the city's people, and most of them are, most of the misdemeanors that occur happen inside the cities. So anywhere crowded people is where most of the law and justice costs are around the state. It's not unique here. He also had to wait to get one of those people out for the city and the city prosecutor to agree. So there were some inefficiencies, and we decided that we worked really hard and to come up with agreements that would basically stop all the duplication of costs. And we felt we could be a little more efficient with our prosecutors. We knew we could be more efficient on the day-to-day running of the jail without having to worry about the billing and the split billing and the who's here on, because that's the other thing. When people commit crimes, they very rarely just commit one. They're usually multiple, and they're in different jurisdictions. So that was a big one, and I personally believe that that's something we're going to have to do more of. Local government is going to have to do more and more of eliminating the redundancy, eliminating the duplication of effort, and we got to figure out a way to save our collective taxpayers' money, because the revenue's not keeping up with expense. So I wanted to say those things on the first page. I won't spend too much time on these other pages, but the data is there in case you have questions. One thing I would like to point out on the bottom of page 2, very bottom, you have salary cost per FTE. This is just in the general fund, and I want to point out that this is something that I think a lot of it bears commenting on, because a lot of people say, oh my God, people in government get paid way too much money. So I want to show you. There is the average salary cost per full-time equivalent employee, $62,179.55. If you want to see salary and benefits, it's up on the top, in the top group. Total personnel cost on average is $83,555.94. Salary, benefits, medical, all those things. What I would point out is that $62,179 in average salaries, most people don't realize the majority of employees in Clallam County have bachelor's or advanced degrees. We have a number of people with PhDs. We are competing for the best and the brightest to do the people's business. This is not a situation that compares really well to, you know, the average salary in Clallam County being $31,000 for a full-time worker. Out there, mostly in retail, if you take a look at any of the state's data, our people, we expect them to be highly trained, highly qualified, highly educated, highly motivated, and you know something, for the most part, they really, really are. We have a great crew, we have great department heads, we've had wonderful elected officials, it's a terrific team. Of folks, and we do compare that salary. We keep those salaries. We look at it every single year with 6 counties that are similar size in Western Washington, and we make sure that we stay in the midpoint of those salaries. Okay, so in case you're wondering. So the rest of the stuff, again, you saw on that page, there was your 72% goes to salary and benefits. The next page, page 3, this is just another way of looking at expenditures. This is by program, and you'll notice that law and justice gets the most of the money, $18 million in 2016, $20,888,000 out of a total budget of $36,789,000. That is also typical. It's what counties do public safety. They spend the great majority of their money on law and justice and on roads for public safety. The next priority is health and human services. General government gets a very small amount of the money, $5.4 million of the total amount of expenditures. Page 4 is revenues, again by object, just another way to look at revenues. Here you see taxes. I highlighted that. Total taxes in 2016 budget, $16,050,000. That's property tax, sales tax, every kind of tax that we get, that we collect, $16 million out of the total budget of general fund revenue of $33,008,000, a little more than half. You see licenses, permits, intergovernmental revenues. Those are things that we do for other governments. $5,000,008. It's charges for goods and services, $7,726,000. Again, those are things that we do for other entities, and they pay us for doing them. A lot of those are grants, fines and forfeits, miscellaneous, other financing sources. So, with that, just as a general overview of the way the county's doing, I would take any questions that people have.
Well, for one thing, appreciate the detail that you've got here. The second thing is a general comment. The counties and cities in rural Washington do not have this sort of picture right now. you in your efforts to maintain this county in a viable economic condition. That's wonderful. The second thing I would look at, in terms of my perspective, looking at your revenue pictures, I had a question. Under 2006, 7, 8, 9, I looked at investment...
Which page are you on?
This is page 2.
Okay.
Investment earnings were well over $2 million a year, and I see you budgeted $300,000 for this year.
Yes.
Is that just a function of the lower interest rates that we're seeing?
It is. Our treasurer's office, and they have a lot of good people working there, work very, very hard to get the most money they can out of investments. And it used to be that, and we're also limited, both by our charter, because of stuff that happened 30-some years ago, commissioners decided to limit even more strictly what the county government can do with investments, more than the state.
Yeah,
all that stuff. So we have limited places that we can put our money. But it used to be, when I first started, and like you said, as far back as you want to look, we used to make $2.5 million on investments in treasurer's cash. And the treasurer's cash has not gone down in that period of time. We still have the same amount of monies available to be invested that always were. But the difference was, we used to earn 5.5% at the state level in just our what basically would be the daily account, and we could get 7-8% in CDs in longer term. And we're limited by how long we can go out there. We can't go more than 3 years without the finance committee asking permission. 2 years now. Thank you. You can't go more than 2 years without special permission through the finance committee, and we just don't do it. We're trying to stay liquid. So yes, the fact that the state rate, which is where we kept most of the money, went from over 5% interest per year to less than 0.1% interest is the biggest reason that it dropped. And that was money that we got to use absolutely without restriction, any way we wanted to, every year. And it was gone. And it's permanently gone. I don't see it ever coming back. Kai.
It seems, looking at the shortfall that's projected for this year, it's not so much a revenue issue as an expense cost issue.
Of course.
Inflation is 2%, revenues are up 4%, expenses are up 14%.
Yes.
I'm not going to ask you why the county commissioners did what they did, because I know you just execute their policy, but maybe you can shed light on to what extent these might be externally imposed mandates, to what extent they are one-time items. One thing that concerns me a little bit looking forward is we increased the headcount by 23, which is more than any time in this whole 15-year timeline that you provided us. And of course, if we go to $1 million to SARP, that's a one-time expense. You can argue whether it's a good idea or not, but it doesn't come. You don't have to do it again in 2017. If you hire 23 people, is your policy never to lay off anybody, that the average rate is $1.5 million a year, that's permanently part of the expense base of the county that doesn't go away.
No, you hit it right on the nail on the head.
Can you comment on the cause for having this increase in employees way above what we have any year in the previous 15 years?
Sure, absolutely. No problem whatsoever. And that is the issue. One time versus ongoing expense. And first of all, we don't have a policy that says nobody will be laid off. It's just that in my 10 years, no one has been laid off. No policy. Okay. And I can tell you, in 2009, controlling the people is the biggest thing. If you take that 23 FTE, as you noted, that we increased this year, and multiply it times the 83,000 average salary and benefits per FTE, suddenly you're in $1.7 million, $1.8 million territory of new money, right? And we're upside down this year on the budget. The budget says the 2016 budget says we're about $2.9 million upside down. I really think now that the commissioners increased the sales tax revenue back, or restored the sales tax cut, that we're going to be closer to $2.2 million, $2.3 million is where we're going to end up. And $1.8 million of that is ongoing. Okay, so the other stuff was one-time use. What I can tell you is last year's board, during the budget cycle, decided that, by golly, we are going to try whatever it is we can, using reserves included, to stimulate the local economy. Well, one of the ways you stimulate the local economy, you make the payment to SARP, or you offer opportunity fund money that's supposed to help get jobs, create work to do the work, same thing with the composite recycling center out of the port, and you put people to work.
So all of those years you saw where we were going down, we were holding the line, and we've been stable the last 3 years, kind of staying where we were. Every department head, and I mean without exception, every department head was chafing at the bit. The work has not gone away, that the people that we, you know, we lost 59 people from our high during the recession. So everybody was needing folks. The board said, well, if we're going to use money and we're going to stimulate the economy with outside people, let's stimulate it with people that live here and work here and will buy stuff at Swain's and go to Necessities and Temptation, pay their taxes, and let's see if we can't ride the national economic gain, which a year ago was anticipated, and I'm not quite so sure it's going to come now, but a year ago that was the board's decision. And we'll hire people, and for 1 year, we got a lot of people retiring. There's the other thing most people don't realize, that almost 60% of our total employee base is 55 or older. We got a lot of people. We're running 45 to 50 every single year that are retiring, and we got to replace them or we don't. So they picked up 23. They said, okay, we got 50-some that are likely to retire next year. If the economy doesn't pick up, if it doesn't stimulate, if we don't see new money coming in, then we'll have to prioritize and maybe not hire all of those 50 people who retire. So there's the answer. It was a calculated decision on the part of the board to spend down reserves a little bit, go from 12 million to 9 million, and was the plan, and hope that the economy picks it up, more sales tax, people come into the area, buy more property tax, and take care of it.
Is a large portion of these people law and justice, which had the biggest increase in the money budget?
Large portion, yeah. Some of it was due to the consolidation, and we had to hire a few more people in the prosecutor's office, and we had to hire a few more people in the court, you know, to handle the increased load. But so some portion, and that's without question, that's our top priority is law and justice. You can see, you can tell everything you want about any business, private or government, by how they spend their money. How do you prioritize what we do? It's how you spend your money. And every county in the state, I will tell you, spends between 65 and 75% of their total money on law and justice. It is the most expensive piece we have. So it would make sense that that would be where we would spend most of our money.
Hey Jim, on the sales tax break issue,
yeah.
I mean, I know we experienced that 15 going into 16 before it was reversed. Have you looked into the numbers on that to see if that indeed did spur business in local economy? Because I can say as a business
you can't
owner,
tell.
you don't have any way of breaking that out.
Oh yeah, I mean, you can look.
You're a history guy. You can't go back prior.
Oh, yeah. Oh well, I mean,
I haven't seen any numbers anywhere that says, hey,
in your book, there's some.
Well, in the prior 6 months, just for that time period.
Yeah, yeah. What I'll tell you, in the last year, during the time that it was about 9 months worth of the sales tax reduction, right? It started 1st of July last year, and it ended 1st of April this year. So we had 9 months. During that period of time, We've averaged about a 14% increase month over month in sales tax collections if we hadn't reduced the rate by 20%. Okay, so we reduced the rate by 20, the collection rate by 20, and had we not reduced it by 20, had we left it at the full amount, it's real easy to do that math. You can tell what you would have gotten at 8.3 versus 8.6. There was an average 14% month over month increase in sales tax revenue. Now, would that have come anyway? There's the problem. Would that sales tax come anyway because there's an increase in the overall state and federal, or would it have been just for that? That you can't tell.
Well, I can say as a business owner, during that time period, when that sales tax decrease came in, it was a benefit to my business because I purchased a large piece of equipment. You're talking $450,000 piece of equipment. Rather than purchase that piece of equipment in Thurston County or Lewis County down south, I purchased that here in Clallam County. So that sales tax went directly into our economy. And I think that other businesses locally did that during that time period.
Sure, sure.
So
I it's hard to pick that out.
Jim, a small point on page 4, revenue by object.
Yeah.
I noticed miscellaneous revenue declined quite a bit in the time period.
Yes.
What's in the miscellaneous?
Before we end the meeting, we need to extend the meeting by another 15 minutes, if that's fine.
So moved.
Yes. All right. All in favor?
Aye.
In this particular case, the big difference in the miscellaneous revenue here was money that we transferred from, it was previous grant money that came from the state that's based on the number of felony trials that you have. They give you for local, it's called local criminal justice. And the state, instead of giving that to us in special revenue funds, and then we transferred ourselves into the general fund, which is why it became miscellaneous, they now directly send it to the general fund. And you'll see the pretty much the same amount of cut. If you look at in 2012, where it used to be 2,790, and it went to 1,470, the same thing, charges for goods and services, went up from 2,900,000 to 6,800,000. Okay? So it was an accounting change. Yes, ma'am.
So, I've been asking questions around the district, and there's a theme of the government isn't working for us.
Okay.
They're not doing things in our best interest. And you had said that regarding the investment interest, the 5% going down to 0.1%, and you stated it won't be back.
That's correct.
So when you say that, are you saying there's absolutely no remedy? I mean, because there's a lot of factors that can contribute to that.
Or not too many.
Because of the current environment.
I'll tell you, there aren't too many factors that contribute to the amount of interest that a local government could use in public money to get. Because it's very restricted. We can't go out in the stock market. There's a lot of things we can't do.
Right.
It really depends on what rates the Fed sets, which they don't give a darn what local governments, they don't give a darn what savers are making, they don't give a darn about, what they give a darn about is $18 trillion worth of federal debt that they have to pay. And back in the day when 10-year T-bills used to be 11-12%, and the federal debt was less than $4 billion, much less $1 trillion, it's $18 trillion now, the government as a whole, the federal government, could afford to make those payments. They cannot afford to make interest on $18 trillion at even 5%. So they have to get that as close as they can to zero. We don't have negative rates the way Japan and Italy and Switzerland and everything have gone to now on their Fed funds. But they get it as close to zero, and if you factor in inflation, it is less than zero that you earn on T-bills. Well, T-bills are one of the things that we can invest in. It's one of the things that the state treasurer invests in. When we give the money to the state treasurer, that's the problem. So until my opinion, and almost every economist that I read, and I get about 14 different economic newsletters that I read all the way from things are going great, it's never going to end, to this is the start of the end of the world, literally. I mean, I that entire group of people I read, they all say that until the federal deficit gets to where the national economy can afford to pay interest rates, savers are going to...
So that's what's driving it.
That's what's driving it. It is driving.
Okay.
That is driving.
Just confirm that. It's not state spending or anything like that.
It's not the state spending. It is driving.
Jim.
Jim, does the county charter allow a means to help 501c3 organizations, worthwhile organizations in the county?
Yes and no. It's not the county charter that's the issue, it's state law. State law says you cannot use public funds to give to a nonprofit. Can't do it. Now, you can hire said nonprofit, and that's how you get around it. You can hire said nonprofit to do worthwhile things for your citizens. Again, in your priority list, and that's how you pay money. You cannot give it away. There's a couple of notable exceptions. There's money in the treasurer or in the auditor's recording fees that has to be spent for certain things. The hard drive money that comes in has to be spent for certain things. But again, those are services that are paid for. They're not direct donations.
Okay.
Yes, so it is. It's a state policy.
How about helping the local economy? Does your charter allow you to work with the city and the chamber and that type of thing? Do you have funds dedicated to attract or help local businesses?
Yes and no. Opportunity funds are the money that we collect, and this is, for those of you that don't know, we're one of the quote-unquote 30 disadvantaged rural counties that gets a portion, 0.9% of the state's portion of sales tax revenue. So with no extra, sales tax doesn't go up because of this. It's the money that the state gets, their 6.5%, they give back to the disadvantaged county, and they give it to the county commissioners to be used for all local government projects that would lead to either retaining or building new jobs. And that's really the only way we can do things. We have interlocal agreements and intergovernmental agreements with the cities that are aiming towards helping the economy, but we don't have the great majority of our money goes to the law and justice, public safety.
Okay. So Jim, there is a lot of discussion now about a carbon tax of some sort that is very likely to raise gas prices. I believe I read under those proposals also possibly include a reduction in sales tax. And so, on one hand, reduction in sales tax impact would be fairly straightforward here, but in terms of this speculation, if there is a substantial increase of carbon and fuel prices, what's that likely to look like?
Well, as you mentioned, first of all, there's all kinds of different proposals. It's impossible to stay up with what all of them are. I kind of have operated my advising of the county and my plans for the future on that. I don't care what politicians do until they've done it, okay? And when they've done it, I then look at it and say, okay, my God, here's what we have. How is it going to affect us? I don't get involved in writing letters on things I think they should do. In fact, our commission has for a long, long time had an unwritten rule that they won't write a letter telling another governmental entity what they think they ought to do. They've done that forever, or at least my whole 10 years here. And I don't write letters, I don't go testify, I don't go and try and influence. First of all, it's illegal for me to influence as an appointed official an issue that is currently either before the people or before the legislature. But I just don't believe in it. Oh my God, you get all wrapped up on what might happen, you're wasting all your time, and I just wait till it happens and then deal with it. Yes?
Would you entertain questions? Legislators?
Oh, I do that all the time.
Okay, cool.
Legislators all the time, quite often actually, and especially the ones I work with, i.e. Commissioner Therringer and Senator Argo.
So you would be
Senator
available?
Oh, I'm totally available, 100%. And I've actually gone and testified on behalf of a legislator twice on their
request,
but yeah, I just don't.
Right.
I just wait till they do it and then figure out what's going to happen.
Very good.
Anybody else?
I'd like you to know before it happens.
Yeah.
John. This is just a practical day-to-day question.
Yeah.
Why did we opt to close the courthouse completely on Mondays? And I understand it was to reduce wages, but if I were doing it, I think I would have said, can we do this as a skeleton crew on Mondays and rotate those folks so that the services were still available.
Well, you never closed the courthouse on Mondays except for holidays.
Really? I was.
Well, you had some, I think you had some off days.
Short hours.
Furloughs.
Furlough days.
No, we never did. What we did during the furlough years is we just reduced the hours of operation from 8 to 7.5. That's all we did. We didn't close an extra day. We just cut a half an hour out of the time. We never closed a day. We contemplated. And we discussed not closing on Monday, but closing a half day on Friday. I mean, you know, but we never did. The commissioners.
I apologize, and because I
never happened.
There was something in my head that said that it was closed on Monday.
I think there were some furlough days.
We had 16 furlough days during the 1 year where we actually closed the courthouse. There's your Monday, okay. And those were all chosen to be Mondays.
Okay.
You're absolutely right. I forgot about that. again, it was to save money. We took everybody, all the department heads, everybody but the elected officials, because we couldn't reduce their salary, but all the department heads, all the appointed, and all of the union folks, and all of the non-represented, and the commissioners voluntarily, and the sheriff voluntarily. We all took a 6.25% cut in pay, reflecting those furlough days that we weren't working, and just to be in solidarity with the union. So those Mondays were 16 days that we did close. The jail was still open, the courts were still open, but the day-to-day operations was not. So you're right, forgot okay. about
and, this. Well, and this my question ago. was really, why close the entire facility? Why yeah. not go to a reduced crew and rotate those so the services were still available?
You know, we talked about that.
Jim, the reason that I'm asking the question is because I actually parked and went, gosh, the parking lot's awfully empty, and yeah. went up and rattled the door.
No, you're myself. Absolutely right. Commissioners, you know, they talked about all kinds of things. One of the things that department heads told us was that over the years, by the time we got to the furlough days, we'd already taken most of the reductions in staff out of general government, because we, by the way, didn't cut any law and justice. Right? Mm-hmm. When all those 49 or 59 FTE that were cut, law and justice grew during that time, right? Because mostly Supreme Court decisions that came in said we had to do thus and so. So nobody has any backup.
Okay.
We were so thin on the front lines and things like the treasurer's office that have dual control issues, that when you're dealing with money, and it just wasn't possible to run with skeleton crews, so the decision was made to close an additional 16 Mondays. That was the way it turned out.
Gotcha.
Thank you. Anything else?
Do you have a question? We have time for one more question if anybody's got it.
I've got a commissioner's meeting at 9, so I really do need to go.
All right, thank you very much. Hopefully we're going to hang around again. I'll see everybody on the 28th. By the way, in addition to that pier thing, an interesting story in the paper today about those mooring buoys and such that were there, and they're trying to put them back, and there's an immense amount of federal regulations they're going to have to go through.
Yeah,
very interesting story in the paper today related to the pier. So.
Thank you.